Hey now, yeah, good morning, PSW staff, clients, friends joining us for Thursday. This is gonna be fun. I mean, we're pretty much through the week. Tomorrow we're gonna see your film screen results for Gladiator. Can't wait to share that with you. You guys did a great, great job. I mean, we've been all over. How much fun was yesterday? Brazil 66 and Sergio Mendes. It's just happy, happy music. I don't care what anyone says. It's so good. Even if it's not your thing, I mean, it's good for us to look at different styles of music. And then a way different style with Mahler, right? I mean, Mahler doesn't sound anything like Brazil 66, but we're looking at different parts of music throughout history, you know, with Mahler's Eighth Symphony. So that was a big one to swallow, but, you know, this is good. That's why I think, you know, Thursdays we like to bring it back home to LA, to the city that we all love. Yeah, I don't have to name the same names every time, but you know who loves this city. And we're going to look at a part of another cultural monument that's been there. I went to a wedding there, but I've never gone to a concert, so maybe another field trip we can do this. It's a beautiful little building. A lot of history actually happened there. Do you want to see some of the history? Well, come on. Let's see some of the history. Today we're going to look at the Wilshire Ebell Theater. Okay, so this place has been there since 1927. The foundation, it's a women's club, was started around 1894, and it was based off this guy's Adrian Ebell. He was a doctor, photographer, but he was a big proponent of women's education. So it's a nonprofit organization, and it the original motto is to interest women in the study of all branches of literature, art, science, the advancement of women in every branch of culture. So it's housed on like Wilshire and Lucerne, so mid Wilshire. It started in downtown in like 1923, Figueroa, you know, because everything was downtown, like we talked about, commerce and trading and all that stuff, business-like, and then, you know, Bullock's Wilshire we start going west, the Culver Hotel west, Beverly Hills Hotel west, you know, all toward the ocean. So this is west on Wilshire Boulevard, this is even west of Bullock's Wilshire. We did the Wiltern, we've done so many things. Wilshire's a really great street based on Gaylord Wilshire, right? Named after him. Okay, so 1927 is, let's get our timeline and look. This is the year before, the big year before Bullock's, before City Hall. A lot of things are happening, a lot of development. This is after the Hollywood sign. This is before Union Station, which we looked at. So you know what I'm going to say next, what happened in 1927, because I like to know what else is going on. Okay, Charles Lindbergh, this is, you know, before the kidnapping, completes the first solo flight across the Atlantic Ocean by himself. I mean, what's scarier than that? And then work begins on Mount Rushmore in 27, you know, where, you know, Mount Rushmore and Washington, Jefferson, Theodore Roosevelt, and Lincoln. Also this year, the first transatlantic telephone call. So from New York to London, that first phone call is made. I don't know how, but somebody makes a phone call. I wonder what it was, you know, what the phone call was. Was it a food delivery? Then also the same year, the jazz singer. Huge. It's going to change all of history. Why? Because sound comes into movies, finally. Jazz singer opens October 6th of this year and it's a huge success with Al Jolson. Now all the silent actors are really going crazy because now they have to be recorded. Now they have to be, you know, they can't just rely on their expressions. Huge sea change, for sure. And then music. I mean, we've talked about music, but now who's going on in the late 20s? Duke Ellington is going on. Count Basie's going on. So we have Gershwin's writing his songs. So we have swing music for the most part, right? It's the roaring 20s. We still are under prohibition. So gangsters are still kind of ruling everything, the country. You know, so there's bootlegging going on. So that's the time that the Ebell comes in. So it's Italian Renaissance. The style is architect is Sumner Hunt. We looked at Sumner Hunt, and so Hunt and Burns, they were asked to design this. Probably the biggest thing Sumner Hunt did was the Bradbury Building, which we might look at. That was in 1892. That's in downtown, used in tons of movies, but that's probably what they're most famous for. Okay, so this is, it's two-story structure. It's faces Wilshire Boulevard, and it's a clubhouse. It has a large lounge, art salon area, and dining room. The dining room opens to like a tiled roof, walkway with a fountain. It's really beautiful. This opens October in 1927. It was originally known as the Windsor Square Playhouse, but opens to the public a few months later with the premiere of Sigmund Romberg's The Desert Song. I don't know that, but that was the first performance that was there. About 1,300 seats. Known for its great acoustics and for its Barton pipe organ, which was used a lot for silent films, because like I said before this, it was all silent films, and what would you use? You would have an organist, right? And we looked at people that would play Fats Waller. Yeah, Carl Stalling is the other one. So what happened there? Probably maybe the biggest thing, I mean, there's a lot of big things that happened in this little, in this building. Not little, but it's no, you know, monument. Judy Garland is discovered there. That's the first time we see her as a 13-year-old. She goes on stage with her two sisters and her mother playing the piano, and a few people take notice of her. Of course, she's going to go on to The Wizard of Oz a few years later from now, but she's going to change the world, Judy Garland. So she's discovered there doing a little stage act at the Ebell. Another huge, iconic female woman is Amelia Earhart, makes her last appearance there. So she's going to disappear a few months from making her last appearance there in speech. That's what she did, because, you know, she was an aviator, of course. But she gives a big speech before she's going to disappear, which is really sad, at the age of 39. So this is the end of hers, her life. A few years later, Igor Stravinsky, we did a class, maybe the second class of Stravinsky in Los Angeles, because he moves in 1942 to Los Angeles. So he starts writing music. Probably the first big thing he writes as an Angelino is a piece I'm actually not familiar with, but he conducted the premiere here, the piece Danzas Concertantes. That's kind of cool. I didn't know he was right there. But I know he lived in the Hollywood Hills, but he conducted it there. And then a few years later, the other most probably important 20th century composer, Arnold Schoenberg. We might do a class on Schoenberg. He's important for us to recognize. I'm holding off on that. Every time I think we should do it, I don't want to alienate people, but there's probably a way we can do it where it's interesting. So I'm getting ahead of myself. But Stravinsky, Schoenberg, probably the most important composers of the 20th century, live within a few miles of each other in Los Angeles, which is really cool. I think they had seen each other, but they were kind of rivals, but that's a whole other story. So Schoenberg, 1945, gives a lot of his new music performances there at the Ebell, 30s and 40s, including the premiere of the Prelude to Genesis Suite, because he's teaching mostly at UCLA, but at USC as well. Okay, so he's there. Another classical composer, pianist more, Glenn Gould. We've talked about him. Remember, he would hum during his piano pieces. Made a lot of Bach music famous, The Art of the Fugue, a lot of great recordings. He gives his final public performance here at the Ebell. Beethoven's Piano Sonata No. 30 and The Art of the Fugue. So that's big. I love La Bamba. It's one of my favorite movies, and so the front of it, the last concert that he does before he performs La Bamba, the front of it is the Wiltern, which we looked at. It's supposed to be I think, the Midwest or Chicago, some other theater. So the inside of his performance of La Bamba was filmed, at the Ebell right there. So that's what it looks like. That's just a personal favorite little scene of mine, so that's why I'm bringing it up. So the Ebell was declared a LA Cultural Historic Monument in 1982. A lot of things happened there. A lot of other films were shot there. A lot of culture has been there. And it's a lot of ethnic diversity, you know, part of the neighborhood shows, you know, Persian, Korean, Russian, a lot of benefits for AIDS concerts there. So I just thought it'd be kind of fun to look at it. Kind of a really beautiful building that's on a smaller scale, but held huge events nonetheless. So that's the Ebell Theater. All right, so tomorrow we get to see your film scoring results for Gladiator. Hope you enjoyed this. Love you guys, miss you. Thanks for watching, and see you tomorrow.